Hello everyone, my name is Ehud Itzhaki and I'm a Principal Product Manager in the Microsoft Entra Identity Division. In this presentation, I will explain the terms phishing and phishing resistance. I will go over offline phishing and real-time phishing flows. And last, I will explain how phishing resistance is achieved by relying on channel binding or on verifier name binding. So let's dive right in. First, let's define phishing and phishing resistant. Phishing attacks are attempts by fraudulent parties to fool an unwary user into presenting an authenticator, either to an imposter who then uses it to authenticate to the legit verifier, or to the legit verifier on a session established by the imposter, such as with out-of-band authenticators. Phishing resistance is the ability of the authentication protocol to detect and prevent disclosure of authentication secrets and valid authenticator outputs to an imposter without a reliance on the vigilance of the user. Authenticators that involve the manual entry of an authenticator output or authenticators that are not directly connected, either wired or wireless, to the endpoint being authenticated are not considered phishing resistant because the authenticator output is not bound to the specific session being authenticated. There are a variety of phishing attack types. Mass phishing has no specific target and is sent to a myriad of people. Spear phishing is directed at specific individuals or companies. Whaling is directed at senior executives and other high-profile targets within businesses. Business email compromise impersonates financial officers and CEOs. Clone phishing uses a legitimate and previously delivered email. Vishing or voice phishing uses a phone call. And smishing uses SMS message. Let's look at a simple phishing attack where the authentication method used is a password. The unwary user most likely received an email with link to an imposter site or downloaded some malware leading to an imposter site. To the eyes of our unwary user, the site looks legitimate and request to authenticate with username and password doesn't raise any suspicion. Our user enters the username and password, gets into the site, browses for a while, and eventually signs out as a good security habit. The imposter is now in possession of the user's credentials, allowing the imposter later to impersonate the legitimate user and successfully authenticate to legitimate site as the legitimate user. Some phishing attacks have advanced to fully replay the request from the site they are impersonating. Tools like Modlishka are making it easy. This is sometimes called real-time phishing and relies on bringing the user to an attacker-controlled machine in the middle. Machine in the middle emulates the login server to the client and the client to the login server and simply repeats whatever it hears from either party to the other. This makes real-time phishing attacks effective against authenticators such as one-time password or out-of-band. The unwary user arrives at the imposter site that immediately starts a session with the legitimate site and replays the response to our user. The unwary user sees the exact authentication UI and flow from the legitimate site and hence enters a username and a one-time password. The user might even enter a password as part of a multifactor authentication. The imposter immediately replaces the credentials provided by the user, successfully authenticating to the legit site. The imposter is now in possession of a valid session, allowing access as the user. Now, let's cover what makes an authentication phishing resistant. Two methods or phishing resistance are recognized: channel binding and verifier name binding. An authentication protocol with channel binding establishes an authenticated protected channel, such as TLS, with the verifier. It then binds a channel identifier that was negotiated in establishing this channel to the authenticator output, for example, by signing the two values together using a private key controlled by the user, for which the public key is known to the verifier. The verifier must validate the signature or other information used to prove phishing resistance. An example of a phishing-resistant authentication protocol that uses channel binding is client-authenticated TLS, also known as mutual TLS, because the client signs the authenticator output with an earlier message from the protocol that is unique to the TLS connection being negotiated. Let's go over the flow. The unwary user arrives at the imposter site that immediately starts a session with the legitimate site and replays the response to our user. Note that each channel has a unique identifier. The unwary user sees the exact authentication UI from the legitimate site and uses a certificate to authenticate. The authenticator output sent to the imposter is a cryptographic signature proving the user is in possession of a private key A and binding to a channel identifier 1. The imposter immediately replaces the authenticator output provided by the user to the legitimate site. However, upon validation of the signature, the verifier immediately rejects the authenticator output since the channel identifier does not match what it expects. An authentication protocol with verifier name binding establishes an authenticated protected channel with the verifier. It then generates an authenticator output that is cryptographically bound to a verifier identifier, which is authenticated as part of the protocol. In the case of domain name system, DNS, the verifier identifier is either the authenticated hostname of the verifier or a parent domain that is at least one level below the public suffix associated with that hostname. The binding can be established by choosing an associated secret, such as a lookup table, by deriving a secret using the verifier identifier, by cryptographically signing with the verifier identifier, or by using similar cryptographically secure means. An example of a phishing-resistant authentication protocol that uses verifier name binding is FIDO, because the verifier identifier, the hostname, is authenticated as part of the WebAuthn protocol and passed via client to authenticator protocol, also known as CTAP, to the FIDO security key to look up the associated secret. Let's go over the flow. The user previously registered the FIDO security key with the legitimate site. In our case, Microsoft.com, as indicated in the lookup table stored on the FIDO security key. The unwary user arrives at the imposter site that immediately starts a session with the legitimate site and replays the response to our user. The unwary user sees the exact authentication UI from the legitimate site and is prompted to use their FIDO security key. The browser passes the authenticated verifier identifier. In our case, it is Microsoft.com with 0 instead of 0. This is passed via CTAP. The FIDO security key looks up an associated secret and can't find one. Hence, the authentication flow is blocked. In this video, we have learned about the types of phishing attacks and the two ways phishing resistant can be achieved: channel binding and Verifier name binding. For more information, please go to aka.ms/phishing-resistant. Thank you.